Morning all. Today we are going to be discussing about few more topics in hashing. So the first topic that we'll be discussing is collision resolution by progressive overflow. First we need to know what is the meaning of collision. Collision is when two or more keys are competing for a same address space, or when two or more keys are competing to occupy the same address space, it is called as collision, because we can't store more than one key in the same address space. So that leads to collision. Now here we are seeing a collision resolution. We need to resolve this collision because it can't occur. If it occurs, there will be data loss. So we have to resolve this collision. The technique here, what we have adopted, is progressive overflow. So the name itself gives a hint about the topic, progressive overflow. We are going to progress and then find another address space where we can search the, where we can suit our keys. So let us go through the explanation. Progressive overflow is a collision resolution technique which places overflow records at the first empty address after the home address. That means if the key is trying to occupy the address 20 and 20 is already being filled, the key will search, that is this progressive overflow technique will search which is the next address that is free after the address 20, and whichever address is free, in the progressive manner, it will not come back and search whether previous to 20 there was any space available or not. It will search after 20, if there was any space available, it will fit your key. Only then it is clear that the file is full and no entries available. So if the file is full, the search comes back to where it begins. So if the file is full, no empty space is available, the search will come back, the technique will come back to the place where the test begin. It will not search in the previous to 20, it will not search. Only when this technique comes back, when the search technique comes back, it is clear that the file is full and no empty addresses is available. With progressive overflow, a sequential search is performed beginning at the home address. And if end of the address is reached, so you, in the usual manner, what was happening, it will start searching for the address from 20. So prior to 20, if there was an address space available, it is not going to search for that address space. Now in progressive overflow, what is happening is, if the address, end of the address is reached without finding an empty space, if the end of the address space is reached, then the wrap around is done and the search continues from the beginning address in the file. In the previous, what was happening, the search will wrap around and come to the place where it started, that is to the address 20. But this will again wrap around and start from the beginning address of the file. So it will again start searching from the starting of the file if there is any place available to fit in your key. So the search is continued until the desired key or a blank record is found. Until a blank record is found, it is going to keep searching. So if the file is full, the search comes back to where it began. Only then it is clear that the record is not there in the file. So where it began, it will come back. We will know that the file is, the record, the particular key is not there in the file. Now progressive overflow is also called as linear probing because it is being done in a linear fashion, one after the other. So it's also called as linear probing. Now here there is a small example which you can see. These are the different keys and these are their home addresses. So Adam occupies the home address as 20. So you can see it has occupied the address 20. Next, Bates occupies the home address as 21. Yes, it is occupied. Next, Cole also tries to occupy the home address 21, which is not possible because in 21 already Bates is present. At 21, if I'm going to store Cole, it is going to result in collision. So I will search for the next free space. Here it was a free space. So I have put a Cole here. Next, Dean. Dean is trying to occupy here. Dean, I can't fit in here because already here Cole is present. So where am I supposed to put? I'm supposed to put in the address 23, whichever is the next free space. Next, come to Evans. Evans is supposed to occupy 20. But in 20, Adams is already present. It will come here and search. Is a free space? No. Is there a free space? No. Here, Dean will already be present. So next free space that is available is a 24. So Ivan is stored at the address 24. Now you can see here what is their home address and what is the address they are actually stored and what is the search length. So for Adams, what is the home address? 20. Where is it stored? Yes, it is 20. So the search length is only one. In one search, you can get it. For Bates, the home address is 21. Where is it stored? 21. Yes, there also the search length is 1. For Cole, the home address is 21. But where is it stored? 22. So the search address is 2. 2 times I need to search in order to find Cole. The next one, Dean, is home address is 22. But where is it stored? It is stored at 23. So again, the search length is 2. It is differing by 2. Next, Evans, it is stored, the home address is 20, but where is it stored? 25. So the search length is 5, it's differing by 5. So these are the different home address, and the actual address means, because if we store it at home address, there was collision occurring. So using progressive overflow technique, we have searched the actual address where they have stored, and we have calculated the search length. Now we will calculate the average search length, which is equals to 2.2, that means add up all the search length divided by the total number of search length. So you are getting an average search length of 2.2. That means on an average, to find a particular key, the number of searching that is required is only 2. The next topic that we are going to discuss is making deletions. So how do we delete a particular key in our address space? Now suppose record Dean is deleted. So record Dean is stored in which address space? 23. So this we have to remember. Now suppose the record Dean is deleted, which makes the address 23 as empty. So when the key Evans is searched, it starts from the home address. So let us say that 23, I have deleted Dean. So now this is empty, correct? Now I want to search for a key that is Evans. What will I do? I will start searching from the first address. Let's say 20, Adams is present, not Evans. So next I'll go for 21. Is Evans present? No. Next I'll go for 22. Is Evans present? No. Next I'll go to 23. In 23, what will be there? A blank space will be there. So what will the searching technique think? That when an empty space is found, it will think that the key is not present, and it will end the searching process. But actually, the key is present after the empty space, right? So the deletion of records leads to this type of problems, because when you delete a record, there will be an empty space, and it is causing a problem because the searching technique is stopped. Now, using the concept of Tombstone technique, there is a technique called as Tombstone. Using this technique, we can resolve this problem. What is the technique? You can see here. What is the difference we are able to find out from this table and the previous table? The empty space is no more. Instead of empty space, we mark the deleted space with hash symbols. So when the searching technique tries to find out Evans, it will come and compare 20. Evans is not present. 21, no. 22, no. 23, it will not stop because there is a empty space. There is not empty space. There is hash symbol. So it will not stop here. It will go for the next address space, that is 24. It will find the respective key and it will return the key. This is called as Tombstone implications. Whenever we are going to delete a particular key, we are going to mark that space with the hash symbol. So here's the explanation. In Tombstone technique, whenever a record is deleted, that address space is marked by a special character. So whenever a special character is encountered, the search continues to the next address without stopping at that point. So this is the explanation given for Tombstone technique. The explanation, whatever I gave, according to this diagram, they have given it in statement format. Let's go through it quickly. Now suppose a new record with key Evans needs to be stored. When the key Evans is dropped to hash function, it produces an address of 20. Now let's say I want to add the add a new key called as Evans. It will find out which is the first empty space. The first empty space is the let us say it produces an address space of 20. But in address space of 20, already Adams is being stored. Since the address of 20 is already occupied by Adams, according to the progressive overflow technique, the search for empty address slot starts when it reaches the address 23. So it can find out that 23, there is a free space. So Evans will be stored here. Okay. So if at all we are adding a new key, then Evans will be stored in the place of 23. Now you can see the next topic that we are going to discuss is storing more than one record per address, that is buckets. So here in the previous diagram, in one address space, how many records are being stored? Only one. Now we are trying to occupy more space. We are going to make more records be stored in one address space. So So storing more than one record per address, we are going to use the concept of buckets. So buckets means we are going to combine many keys, more than one key, and store it inside one hash address. So that is nothing but bucket. So you can see here an area of hash table with a single hash address. Only one address will be there, but it has room for more than one record. It can store more than one record. So if you can see here, in the hash address 20, I'm able to store two records, Adams and Evans. Here the counter indicates how many records are being stored. In the address 21, two records are being stored, Bates and Cole. So this storing is based on their home address. We had the home address right here. In the address 20, there were actually two records to be present. So we have stored Adams and Evans. In 21, two records were supposed to be present, Bates and Cole. So the previous method, if you are storing only one record per address, you can't store two records in the same address. But using the concept of buckets, I can store two records in the same address and there will not be any collision also. So the use of buckets will reduce the average number of probes required to find a record. Previously, in order to find coal, right? The address was 21, but the actual address is 22. The average search length was 2, but now that is going to be reduced with the use of buckets. So the use of buckets will reduce the average number of probes required to find a record, because it is the address of coal is 21 and it is present at 21. It is not present at 22 or 23. So the number of probes required to search for that record is also reduced by using the concept of buckets. Next, we are going to see other collision resolution techniques. So till now, we have studied about one collision resolution technique, that is progressive overflow, right? Now we are studying about another collision resolution technique, that is double hashing. You already know what is hashing. It's a function which will calculate the address where your key has to be stored. Double hashing means once you get the address where your key has to be stored, you're going to perform again one more hashing function on the same address to find out the actual address where you have to store the key. Now let us see the explanation. Double hashing is similar to progressive overflow. The second hash value is used as a stepping distance for probing. So because this is going to reduce the collision, we are not going to store the key in the same address. We are going to find out one more address. How? By performing hash function again. So the second hash value should be relatively prime to the size of the table. So it should be relatively prime. If there is a collision at the hash address, so if there is a collision, only then go for double hashing technique. If there is no collision, then there is no necessary to resolve the collision. So if there is a collision at the hash address, produced by the hash function. So this is the hash function which has produced the address, and at that address there is a collision. Say X, this is the address that is being produced by this hash function. Then the key is dropped to the second hash function to produce a C. So the we are performing one more time hash function using this address. Okay. Then once you are getting two addresses, we have got this address by the first hash function. You have got this hash address by the second hash function. Add the two addresses. So when you add the two addresses, you're going to get some value. Right? In that value, you are going to store your record. So the new record is going to be stored at the address X plus C. So X is the result of first hashing function. C is the result of second hashing function. So your actual record is going to be stored at the address X plus C. This is called as double hashing technique. It is one of the collision resolution technique. The next, there is one more technique. It is called as chained progressive overflow. What is this chained progressive overflow? Chained progressive overflow forms a linked list or a chain of synonyms. It is going to store the records in the form of a chain. Each home address contains a number indicating the location of the next record. It is similar to your linked list. So each address will tell you where is the location of the next record. The next record in turn contains a pointer to the other record. So in turn it will contain pointer to the other record. Now consider this table. You already know this table, right? There are some keys and there are some home addresses. Consider this table. these are the keys, these are the home address, and this is the actual address where they are stored. Now, what is this address of next synonym? What is the first record Adams? It is stored at the address 20. What is the next record Bates, right? So the next record is stored at what address? 22. So the address of the next synonym is stored here. What is the next address where it is being stored? The next one, see, Adams is stored at the address 20. At the same address, who was supposed to be stored? Cole. But where is it stored? 22. So the address 22 is stored in the place of Adams. The next one, Bates, it is stored at the address 21. At the 21, one more record was supposed to be stored, that is Dean. Dean is stored at the address 23. So this number is stored here. So synonym means at the same address, there was supposed to be one more key. Where is that key stored? That information is got by this column, address of the next synonym. This is called as chained progressive overflow. Each home address is going to contain an indication of where the next record with the same home address is found. See, Adams and Cole is having the same home address. So Adams is going to contain information about where Cole is present. Cole is present at the address 22. That address is being stored here. Now, Bates is having the same home address as Dean. So Bates is going to contain information about where Dean is present. Dean is present at the address 23. That is stored here. So this, they are going to contain information about where the next synonym is present. So the example is shown here. Now, let us go through the explanation. Now, suppose that Dean's home address was 22 instead of 21. Let's say, where is Dean? Dean's home address was 22 instead of 21. Now, at 22, who is present already? Cole is already being present. By the time Dean is loaded, the address 22 is already occupied by Cole. So, Dean ends up at the address 23. So, does this mean that Cole's pointer should point to 23? If the pointer is 25, then the linked list joining Adams, Cole, Flint is kept intact. But Dean is lost. That means if Dean was supposed to be stored in the place of Cole. So, should Cole contain an indication about where Dean is stored? Or if the pointer about Dean is 25, then or the information about Evans and Flint is being lost. So this problem is addressed by two solutions. What are the two solutions? Two pass loading. Other one is chaining with a separate overflow area. What is this two pass loading? As the name implies, it involves loading a hash file in two passes. On the first pass, only home records are loaded. So only the records which are having the home address, they are loaded. All the records that are not home address are kept in the separate file. So whichever is having duplications, like for example, in 20, two records were supposed to be stored. So one record is kept as home record, other one is kept in a separate file. On the second pass, each overflow record is loaded and stored in one of the free addresses according to whatever collision resolution technique is being used. So in the first pass, whichever is having the unique address, they will be stored in a separate file. In the second pass, whichever record is causing an overflow, they will be loaded into the free address, whichever is available according to the collision resolution technique. This is called as two-pass loading. It is not a collision resolution technique. It is a technique for loading your file. While loading, it should not cause collisions. So that is why first all the records with unique addresses is being stored into one separate file. In the second pass, the records whichever is causing the collision, they are stored in the free space whichever is available. The next solution was chaining with a separate overflow area. We are going to have a separate area which is called as overflow area. And we are going to link the actual records with this overflow area. One way to keep the overflow records from occupying the home address. We don't want the overflow records to occupy the home address. So what we are going to do according to the topic, we are going to separate and store them in a separate area and we are going to link them. So the set of home addresses is called as the prime data area and the set of overflow address is called as the overflow area. So you can see in the example diagram here, this is called as the prime data area and this is called as the overflow data area. So first, address that is 20, Adams is going to be stored. Next, the next record that is Cole also occupies the same address. So I'm not going to store it in the next free space 22. I'm going to store it inside another area called as overflow area. This is called as the overflow area and I'm going to link it. Can you see here? There is a link. That is the meaning of the statement. Chaining with a separate overflow area. So I'm going to chain the primary data area and the overflow data area. Next, again, the address 21 is having two records, that is Bates and Dean. So Bates will be stored here and Dean will be moved to the overflow area. In 24, there is Evans that is stored. If there is no more free space, you can store even Flint also here. So whichever address is having two or more records, you keep the primary record in the primary data area and whichever is overflowing, you can store it inside the overflow data area. These are the different collision resolution techniques that we have studied today. Thank you all.